Hello. In today's session, we are discussing, going to discuss about water treatment. There are several options of water treatment available, and say several treatment units are also available. How much units we are going to use depends upon, or what are the units we are going to use, it depends upon the degree of treatment required. The degree of treatment in turn depends upon what is the, say, raw quality water, as well as what is the quality of the intended supply. So we are having some separate water quality standards depending upon the purpose, such as, say, domestic water supplies, industrial water supplies, and say irrigation water standards. Normally for treatment purposes, it is intended to supply only for the domestic use, or say drinking water standards are getting satisfied, should be satisfied for our purpose. So the various options available for treatment include, say, screening, then sedimentation, with or without flocculation, then comes filtration, disinfection, etc. These are the conventional treatment units normally employed for a water treatment plant. In addition, depending upon certain other special quality requirements, there are some special methods for removal of iron and manganese, and defluoridation, removal of taste and odors, water softening, desalination, etc. So these are normally employed only under some special requirements depending upon the specific use. So let us now discuss all of these methods in brief, so as to have a thorough insight into the processes used. So as I earlier told, all of these processes may not be used simultaneously or at the instant. It depends upon how much is the quality of the water required for us, and also on the raw water quality which is available with us, and what is the impurity content in our raw water. So let us see what you mean by the screening process. So screening is the process or method employed for the removal of floating substances. So it removes the floating matters. Say large floating substances like some debris, say wooden particles, broken down trees, trunks, branches, all such materials are getting removed by the process of screening. Now where are these screens installed? So these screens are installed in the beginning in the intake works itself. Before the water is taken for distribution system, in the intake works itself, before the pumping operation started, the screens are installed. So how these screens are designed, or what are the various types of screens available, are say the bar screens, which we otherwise call as the core screens, and sometimes we go for some fine screens in the form of mesh type. So the mesh type screens are also being used. So the bar screens or rack screens are nothing but they consist of parallel racks or gratings, which may be circular or rectangular in section, and they are aligned horizontally to the direction of flow. For general purposes, they are inclined at an angle of around say 40 to 60 degrees to the horizontal. They are not kept in the ideal horizontal direction. The reasons for inclination is to increase the flow of surface area and reduce the flow of velocity to have the better screening operation. And the velocity to be maintained is in order of 0.8 to 1 meter per second through the screen openings. So this velocity should be maintained whenever we design the screens for the purpose of screening. And the materials which are getting deposited in front of the screens normally called screenings. So the materials which we remove through the screens are known as screening. So this screening is getting removed either manually or they can be removed mechanically also through scrappers. So the scrappers travel in front of or scrap the materials or the screenings in the front of the screens. So the inclination is around 40 to 60 degrees to the horizontal to increase the surface area of flow and to reduce the flow velocity. And the velocity should be maintained in the order of around 0.8 to 1 meters per second. And this kind of things are most widely used, and sometimes the mesh type screen or fine screens are also used, in which we have some wires or wire mesh or gratings which run in both the directions. So this is about the screening process. The purpose of it in the intake works itself to remove the floating matters. These floating matters otherwise damage the pumps. So you are having some water supply pipes, they damage the pumps, they damage the distribution network, and they cause hindrances or say affect the other treatment processes which are to be followed successively. Next, we are going to see about what do you mean by sedimentation. So after the process of screening, what we see is nothing but our sedimentation process. So now what is this sedimentation? So sedimentation is the process of removing readily or easily settleable solids. So some of the solids which are present in water, they can be very easily removed by means of retaining them under some quiet conditions. When we retain the water body which is not under disturbed condition, the solids get easily settled. So that kind of easily settleable solids can be removed by plain sedimentation. So plain sedimentation is nothing but removal of easily settleable solids. So for this we have to create a quiet condition by means of providing the required retention period. The retention period is nothing but the time of period during which the water takes to travel during the length of the tank. Is the time taken for the water particle to travel the entire length of the tank, and otherwise is the period for which the water is retained inside the particular sedimentation basin. So it is it varies for a plain sedimentation for around say 4 to 6 hours. So during this period all easily settleable solids will settle at the bottom of the sedimentation basins. So how these tanks are being provided? So these tanks are normally an horizontal flow tank as well as vertical or upflow tanks. So both horizontal flow tanks and vertical upflow tanks are available for treating the water by the sedimentation process. So the horizontal flow tank may be further rectangular in section or they may be also circular in section. So both all these cases they may be either say rectangular or circular in shape. So in a horizontal flow, rectangular tip, the flow will enter at the one end or one length, one side of the tank, and it will traverse to the length of the tank, and through a overflow where it will exit at the other end. Similarly, in a circular flow tank also, various patterns are available. Say the flow will enter through the peripheries, and the outlet is also let out to the periphery or circumference of the circumferential wear. And the vertical or upflow tank, the flow will be normally, so if you are having the sedimentation basin, the flow will enter through the center of the tank and it will flow radially, that is from bottom to top, and then it will be radially dispersed in all the directions. In the case of a vertical upflow circular tank, and in the circumference of periphery we are having some weirs or overflow weir through which the effluent or clear liquid spills over and which can be drawn for further treatment. So this is an arrangement for a vertical upflow tank where the water enters the through the center of the tank, and it radiates out equally in all the directions and spills out to the circular via wherein the water can be taken for subsequent treatment. So similarly, a horizontal flow tank, the water is going to travel throughout the length of the tank, provided with the required detention period. During this detention period, the individual distinct particles will try to settle at the bottom of the tank. Now, what is the velocity which governs this settlement? So, these discrete particles will have a settling velocity which is given by the Stokes' law as Vs equal to G by 18 into S minus 1 T squared by mu, where Vs is the settling velocity G is the acceleration due to gravity S is the specific gravity of the settling particle D is the dia of the particle and mu is the kinematic viscosity. So during the period of settlement or the detention period for which the tank is designed, the settling velocity can be calculated and it should following that and during the detention period, when the particle traverses with this settling velocity, it should adequately reach the bottom of the basin. The length of the tank or the basin should be designed in such a way such that during that period it easily settles down at the bottom before it reaches the other opposite end. That is the principle or concept behind this plane sedimentation, wherein the particle with the settling velocity reaches the bottom of the tank before the particle reaches the other end of the tank. So this is about the plane sedimentation, which is suitable or ideal only for some easily settleable solids. But not all particles or solids are easily settleable. Some of the solids or particles are very fine in nature or colloidal in nature. They cannot settle down on their own because of their lesser specific gravity or they are less dense. So how to make these particles settle? So this is done by aid with some coagulants, and this process we call as normally coagulation. So coagulation is a chemical term . So coagulation is nothing but the process of adding chemicals for destabilizing the colloids. So we are normally having colloids in our water. These colloidal particles are all normally negatively charged. So these negatively charged colloidal particles repel each other and therefore they do not settle on their own. So we have to add some chemicals or coagulants which will supply the positive ions, and these positive ions will try to say neutralize the charge. That is neutralization. And further to aid this settlement, we have this flocculation. So this flocculation is nothing but slow mixing process wherein the particles agglomerate or grow in size. So the neutralized colloidal particles say come closer to each other along with the colloids, say along with your coagulants what we have added, and they are made to grow in size through the flocculation process, where it is nothing but a slow mixing process. So sedimentation without flocculation, first we will go for some coagulations. So coagulants are nothing but the chemicals which are added for neutralization of the electrical charges of the colloids by supplying the positive ions. And these coagulants normally used for the water treatment are nothing but, most commonly we go for alum or say RMR, aluminium sulfate in the hydrated form. And next comes, most widely used is the ferrous sulfate or copperas. Then we are also going for the use of chlorinated copperas. So these are some of the most widely used coagulants and the chemicals which are used for the coagulation process. That is, they supply the aluminium sulfate, the positive ions of the aluminium will try to neutralize the negative ions of the colloids and form a flock. So this flock form will be further taken together through the flocculation process. So the colloids commonly used are this alum or aluminium sulfate, ferrous sulfate and chlorinated coppers. So how this process is carried out? That is, correctly speaking, both this coagulation and flocculation are indicated by the term coagulation only, but the strict difference is, much difference is there between what is a coagulation process and what is a flocculation process. So how to go for this process? So first we will have some mixing. This mixing should be first done a rapid process. So rapid mixing, we will go for some baffle type. Baffle type basins. Then we are having some mechanically agitated basins. So mixing can be done either through the baffle type or mechanically agitated basins. So what is this baffle type basins means? We will have some baffle walls. In the basin, so this is say the elevation, sectional elevation. So in the sectional elevation, the water is going to enter at the one end and it is going to travel over and under the baffles. So in the sectional elevation, if the water moves through the baffle walls, that is first under, then over and under the baffle, this is the over and under the baffle type. So here the due to the disturbances created due to the travel, during the travel of the required liquid mass as well as the say your coagulants, there is a large turbulence created, and because of this turbulence the thorough mixing is achieved in the baffle type basins. Similarly, the same view when we take in the plant wise, it becomes the other type, which is nothing but around the end baffle type. So the same thing, when the basin you view in the plant view, it is going to travel around the baffle walls in the plant, and we call this the around the end baffle type, and here also the thorough mixing is being achieved. But this has having some drawbacks, such as when compared to the mechanical agitated basins, the thorough mixing is not that much achieved in this. So we go for a mechanical agitated basin wherein we will first have. So how we go for a mechanical agitated mixing basins? The first process we call it as a rapid mixing. Which is done for neutralization of electrical charges of the colloids. At rapid mixing, we go for some flash mixtures, and then we go for some flocculators. That is, a slow mixing process is being done in these flocculators. So, what is a flash mixture? So, a flash mixture will essentially have an impeller shaft with impeller blades. So the water or the which along with the coagulants is fed into the flash mixer tank, and the impeller shaft is made to rotate at the say around 125 rpm speed, and we have to provide a detention period of around half to 1 minute. So half to 1 minute detention period is being provided. So that's only fast mixing. We are going for neutralization of the electric charges of the colloids. So the water is allowed to enter along with the coagulants in one end of the flash mixer tank, and the impeller shaft is made to rotate at 125 rpm speed, and T3 is allowed to detain for a period of around say half to 1 minute. So during this period, the chemicals are made to mix with the water and neutralize the electric charge of the colloids. So the output or the effluent of the flash mixers are then taken for the say a flocculator or a slow mixer, where the agglomeration or size increase of the particles take place in the flocculators. So what are these flocculators? Are nothing but they will have long horizontal shafts, and to these each shafts the impeller blades are being attached, and which they rotate along this tank at a slower speed, and the detention period of this flocculator tanks is around say 30 to 60 minutes. So the detention flash mixture is very small comparatively to a flocculation tank, where a detention period of 30 to 60 minutes is provided in a say your flocculator. So they will have one horizontal shafts which is rotating with the required number of impeller blades. So these blades will agitate the mass of the liquid in a slow manner. So during this slow mixing, the flocks which are getting formed in the flash mixing are say only like mass substances. So original colloids which are scattered in the water sample. So now after this flocculation process, they form some cotton or say woolly masses which are more in weight compared to the negative colloids, and by means of its higher weight or density, they easily settle down when they are allowed to settle quietly in the after flocculator. They may be taken to a the sedimentation basin, where in the required detention period. So for this purpose, the required detention period is around 2 to 4 hours. So when we have a sedimentation basin with the aid of coagulation or flocculation, the detention period provided is around 2 to 4 hours. And this will help in the removal of all negative colloids which are not getting removed in the plain sedimentation process. So further we will see how to still get rid of the finer particles which are still present in the water sample without still with the use of screening and sedimentation. It is not sufficient to remove all these particles. So finer colloids as well as some bacterial constituents are further removed through the filtration process. Now what is this filtration process and what are the various types of filters available? So filtration is nothing but we'll use some filter media for removal of finer colloids or finer impurities bacterial impurities So now what is the mechanism of action which happens in a filter? So one is what we know is through the straining, then there will be some adsorption, then there is biological metabolism. So as we see physically, what appears to us as filter only filters by means of some mechanical strain. But it is not only the process, In addition to this, each of the, so we know that the common filter media employed is the sand. So in this sand layers, we will have some, say each of the sand layers will try to act as some sedimentation basin on its own, and thereby it will attract the, say, other impurities which are present in the water, and it will try to grow its cells. So it is the adsorption process, and it's the surface phenomena wherein attracts the other impurities. In addition to this, there are some biological activities or metabolism which are also responsible for the filtering action. So a humus duct layer or a surface coating of bacterial impurities is formed around the sand grains, and this layer form will try to attract and remove all the bacterial and other final impurities and grow in cells. So this is also responsible for removal of the impurities through the filtering process. So an electrolytic approach metabolism is also found to be responsible for this. So we will have some physical or mechanical straining, then is the surface phenomena of adsorption, as well as some biological metabolism or biological activity in the surface layer in the form of the humus duct layer. So this humus duct or gelatinous coating of the bacterial film around the sand grains will attract the say the sand particles around them, and it will grow in size, and that's the reason during the passage of time the filter gets clogged and it needs to be regenerated or getting backwashed. So this is the common metabolism or mechanism of filtration which is most widely seen in the slow sand filter. So most of this mechanism is also responsible for the action involved in the rapid sand filter. So there is some difference in metabolic activities between the slow sand filter as well as a rapid sand filter. So now we will see how a slow sand filter. So before that we will see what are the types of filters commonly available for treatment process. So one of them, as we know, is a slow sand filter. The other one is a rapid sand filter. Then nowadays we are going for some pressure filters also. So the major difference between the slow sand and rapid sand filter, as the name suggests, is lies in the rate of filtration itself. So a slow sand filter will go for some around 100 to 200 liters per hour per meter square, whereas for a rapid sand filter the rate of filtration is around some 3000 to 6000 liters per hour per meter square. So the basic difference between these two types lies in the rate of filtration. So how we are going to use a slow sand filter? Very briefly we can also discuss about this. So in the slow sand filter we have various layers. So the main filtering media is nothing but the, so the bottommost will have some base material. So this base material is made up of gravel, and then the filtering media is sand, of some sand of layers with the effective size 0.2 to 0.4 mm. This is the effective size of the sand. So the sand to be used in a slow sand filter will have an effective size of 0.2 to 0.4 mm. So the overall water depth, or this depth of the filter media will lie around say 3 meters. So this is the average depth of the used mostly for the slow sand filters. So this will have some 4 to 5 layers. So 4 to 5 layers of sand are getting packed, say to a total thickness of around 60 to 90 centimeters, and we are having an effective size of 0.2 to 0.4 mm, and below this base material we are having or providing for an under drainage system. So an under drainage system consists of have laterals, and it will connect to the say the collecting pipe or manifold, So the laterals are nothing but pipes which are having perforations or holes at their top, which are spaced at their spacing of around some 2 to 10 centimeters, center to center, which will have some. So this is the plan. These are the arrangement of the laterals. So these laterals will be sloping in one direction, and the water will be collected through an outlet chamber. So the slope of the bed is provided accordingly, wherein the water connected to the laterals will pass to the main pipe and manifold, and eventually it will discharge to the outlet chamber where it is further being collected. So it is allowed to, the water is allowed to stand here. So the area of this filters is somewhat very large. Each individual units may vary, say even up to 30 by 50 meters. And since the rate of filtration is small, the area involved or the area required is very large. Whereas in the case of the rapid sand filter, is just reverse of that. So we discuss that when we go for the rapid sand filter. So the filter is allowed to stand water over the sand layer, and it will necessitate a loss of head, and thereby the mechanism of filtration process will take place, and the clear water or effluent flows through the under drainage system into the outlet chamber. So this is a, say after the prolonged usage of filters, there is the loss of head exceeds the permissible value. So we need to go for the cleaning of the filters. So in the case of rapid sand filter, the cleaning is done by scraping of the top layers. So the slow sand filter, the cleaning process is done by scraping of the top layer. So for this scraping, the first few centimeters sand layer is getting removed, and it is getting replaced by the further fine sand of say effective size 0.2 to 0.4 mm. Next we will see what is the treatment behind the rapid sand filter. So a rapid sand filter will have say a much smaller area due to the heavier rate of filtration. As we have seen, the rate of filtration here is around 3000 to 6000 liters per hour per meter square. So the size of the individual unit is pump around 5 to 8 meters. So this is the size of the individual units in the case of a rapid sand filter. Because the rate of filtration is heavier, smaller units are sufficient for rapid sand filter, and nowadays we are going for use of only the rapid sand filters because of the benefits which are going to attain by using them. So in a rapid sand filter also, the filtering media is the sand. So the effective size here is, so the effective size is 0.35 to 0.5 mm of the sand grains. So the size of the sand grains will have an effective size of 0.35 to 0.5 mm, and the base material here is also a gravel with different layers of gravel packing, with the say finer gravel at the top layer and the smaller gravel at the bottommost. And similarly, sand is also being packed into a depth of around 60 to 90 centimeter, with finer sand at the top and the coarser sand at the bottom layers. The major difference of operation here involves in the washing of the filters. In the case of this rapid sand filter, the cleaning is done by means of backwashing. So an adequate quantity of water, say 1 to 5% of the water which is being passed, should be reserved for the purpose of backwashing. So backwashing is nothing but the water which is getting collected in the outlet chamber will be further collected, and they will allow to pass through the central manifold. So in the case of the under drainage system in a rapid sand filter, we will have a central manifold pipe. So these are the various laterals which will collect the water, and it will slope towards the central manifold pipe. So this is the manifold in the under drainage system, and these are all the laterals, which is divided into two halves. So these laterals will slope towards the central longitudinal manifold, which are having some perforations or holes in them. These are the perforations or holes. So through the perforations or holes, the water gets collected in the lateral, and they get sloped towards the central manifold pipe, and through that it is collected to an outlet chamber. Now during this backwash process also, the same thing, the water gets flows in the reverse direction from the manifold through the laterals and through the gravel layer and finally to the sand layer in the reverse direction. So the water gets flows from the, so through the help of the air compressor unit, the water is going flow through the under drainage system into the gravel packing and finally to the sand layers, and you will have a wash water trough at the top of this. So through these tubs, the water gets, the wash water gets collected, and all the clogging impurities are getting removed by the backwashing process. So this is the process of, say, backwash or cleaning of the filter media in the case of a rapid sand filter. So this backwashing or cleaning is generally required in the period of, say, around once in 24 hours for half an hour period. So in a 24 hour cycle, the period of operation is for 23.5 hours, and remaining 30 minutes it is used for backwashing. And the backwashing amount will be, say, 1 to 5% of the water which is being getting filtered to the rapid sand filters. So this is the major difference in operation between a rapid sand filter and a slow sand filter. So we can now summarize some of the key differences between a slow sand filter as well as a rapid sand filter. In the case of a slow sand filter, the area of the individual units, say the individual unit size is around only 30 to 50 meters. It's a very large size, corresponding the area involved is higher. Whereas in the case of a rapid sand filter, it is around 5 to 8 meters and the area involved is smaller. And the rate of washing is 100 to 200 liters per hour per meter square. Whereas in the case of rapid sand filter, it is around 3000 to 6000. So what are the kinds of impurities are removed in each? So if you take the rapid sand filter, say a slow sand filter, it is good in removing the bacterial efficiency. So the bacterial efficiency in the slow sand filter is around, say, 98 to 99%. Slow sand bacterial impurities are removed, and you cannot remove turbid waters more than 50 milligram per liter. So turbidity it can remove up to 50 ppm. More than that it cannot remove it. Whereas if you go for a rapid sand filter, the bacterial efficiency is only around some 80%, and turbidity can remove even more than 50 milligram per liter. So pre-treatment requirement, there is no much harder pre-treatment requirement for a slow sand filter, such as say sedimentation or coagulation. Whereas when you go for a rapid sand filters, the pre-treatment, say sedimentation, coagulation is mandatory. And cleaning is by means of scraping the top layers. And in the case of a rapid sand filter, the cleaning is done by means of the backwashing for backwashing. And the initial cost of construction is high in the case of a slow sand filter, and the initial cost of construction is less in the case of a rapid sand filter. Coming to the operating cost of the slow sand filter is very less, say is very less compared to the operating cost of a rapid sand filter, wherein since the backwashing everything is getting involved. And this is more, the rapid sand filter is most widely used nowadays for achieving a higher rate of filtration. And as I told already, the bacterial efficiency of a slow sand filter is much higher when compared to the bacterial efficiency of removal of a rapid sand filter. So these are some key differences of points between a slow sand and a rapid sand filter. And skill of operation, etc. Say we can go for lesser skilled persons in the case of a slow sand filter compared to a rapid sand filter. So this is about the filtration process where we are going for the use of rapid sand and a slow sand filter. In addition to these two, a little advancement of the rapid sand gravity filter is nothing but the pressure filter. So this both slow sand and rapid sand filter will act under the gravity type, whereas the pressure filter it acts under the additional pressure, it is not under the gravity type. So the pressure filter are also nothing but a rapid filter, where the rate of strength is very high compared even to the rapids and filter, and they are more compact units, and since the rate of filtration is much higher, the size of the filter gets much reduced.
Okay.
This is the major advance, and we will have some very small compact units for the pressure filters, and they are used for some certain industrial requirements, say the filter media and the sand media is used as in the case of all other filters here also, and you can see that it is a very compact cylindrical unit and is used mostly for industrial operation, since the cost of operation is and the maintenance of these filters are more higher, and the prerequisite water treatment is also being much heavier. So we cannot use this for say our domestic purposes or in the domestic water treatment plant because of the higher initial cost, and say it is not feasible to treat such a large volumes of water to the pressure filters, and they are normally employed for say some specific industrial operations. So this is about the various filters. So the major type used for domestic purposes are the say slow sand as well as rapid sand, and nowadays we go mostly for the rapid sand filters. After all completion of all these things, we will finally go for the disinfection process. Now what is this disinfection? So what is disinfection means? Disinfection is nothing but killing of germs. So in simple words, disinfection refers to the process of killing of germs or say harmful bacterial substances which are present in the water. So in the absence of any other treatment, say army people normally they go only for the disinfection. So we cannot whatever the source of water is available to those people, they will collect that source of water, and without using any other technologies, they go simply they will use some kind of disinfectant with them. So the agents which are used for this disinfection process we call it as a disinfectant. So they will add any of the say some bleaching powder or some chlorinating compound will be normally bleaching powder is there. So the very small quantity of the compound is added, and they will consume it during the emergency warfare times. So this disinfection is nothing, as I told you, killing of germs or bacterial impurities through the aids of some agents. Now what are the various disinfectants used? So disinfectants used, so most commonly or widely used is the chlorination or chlorine compound. In addition to this, we are also going for the use of some potassium permanganate, then comes the treatment with the bromine and iodine. Treatment with bromine and iodine, potassium permanganate, treatment with ozone. So these are and the most commonly we shall go for is the boiling of water. So boiling of water we can do only in a smaller scale because it is not practically feasible to employ it or treat it for a large domestic requirements in a treatment plant. So this is otherwise also known as sterilization, wherein we can do this process only in the homes, because the volume of water required in the home for 4 to 5 people is very much lesser, so you can easily boil the water sample in the homes and use it for our purpose. But otherwise these are the other commercially used viable methods, that is using chlorination or chlorine compounds, then potassium permanganate also being used, then use of treatment using even silver is being practiced through the Kaledin process, and bromine and iodine is used, and ozone or O3, that is the molecule of oxygen, is also being passed and used for the disinfecting process. Now chlorine or chlorination is available in the various forms. See what is this chlorination is the most widely used. So we can use in the form of chlorine, in the form of powder. So commonly it is available as hypochlorites, that is bleaching powder. So chlorine in the form of hypochlorites is available as bleaching powder. So that is very commonly used for the disinfection process, wherein easily the residual chlorine. So in the chlorination, what we have to see is that after the disinfection and killing of germs is done, the necessary residual chlorine is, that is freely available residual chlorine is maintained in the sample or the water under treatment. So it indicates that the chlorination is sufficient. So in the absence of free residual chlorine indicates that chlorine is not sufficient, and we may have to rescind the process so that free residual chlorine is available at the end of the chlorination process. So in addition to the powder form, so chlorine in the form of say in the cylinders, in the liquid forms, say in the output in the gas form is also being used. So most commonly it is available in the form of say powder form as hypochlorites. So chlorine as hypochlorites. Are most commonly used for the disinfection process. Say commercially it is named as the bleaching powder, and it is having a very easily available one and a cheaper one, and it is having a good disinfecting power. So what are the various stages of this chlorination? So we are having some various terms available with this. Say during when you add the chlorine gradually, we have the point at which the chlorination is effective, which we call as the breakpoint chlorination. Then how to do this chlorination is, one is the post chlorination, the other one we call it as the pre chlorination, that is the stage during which you add the chlorine to the water sample. So post chlorination is the most widely used, that is the addition of chlorine at the end of all other treatment processes. And pre chlorination denotes the addition of chlorine before the starting of the process, that is before the all the treatment processes we add the chlorine, that is known as the pre chlorination. Then we have some more residual chlorine to be maintained in the form of some superchlorination. So superchlorination denotes the addition of excess of chlorine so as to have a more effective free residual chlorine. Thus we have seen that how to remove or treat the water for conventional impurities for a normal domestic water treatment unit using the units of screening. And next we have seen what is the sedimentation in terms of plain sedimentation as well as in terms of sedimentation with coagulation. So sedimentation with coagulation, we have seen how we are going for mixing by baffle type mixing basins as well as mixing through mechanically agitated basins in the form of flash mixer as well as a flocculator. So a flash mixer, we go for a rapid mixing of the input to raw water as well as the coagulant and nucleation of colloidal particles, and whereas the stabilization or agglomeration of the particles will take place in a slow mixing process or a flocculator. And we have also seen what is the filtration, what is the mechanism of filtration involved, and what are the various types of filters available, such as a rapid sand, a gravity and a slow sand filter, that is the slow sand and rapid sand filter of the gravity type and a pressure filter of a non-gravity type, and what is the basic difference of actions or operation in the case of a slow sand filter and a rapid sand filter. And finally we have seen what is a disinfection process, that is of the killing of germs, and what are the various disinfectants used, such as the most widely used one of chlorination, then some other agents like potassium permanganate, bromine and iodine, ozone and the boiling of water. So I hope all this will help us to learn how to remove the impurities in water. And this treatment which is to be used depends, as I told you, on the amount or the quality of the raw water as well as what is the quality of standards which will be based upon the intended use. So normally for a domestic water supply, we are having some Indian drinking water quality standards according to our IS specifications, and if you have some specific industrial needs, normally the industrial requirements are to be satisfied only by the specific industries. So the domestic water supply is not intended to supply for the industrial water requirements, only it is intended to for some domestic supplies. And irrigation water standards are also not being met with here, wherein the requirements will be more specific in terms of some say boron as well as some sodium concentrations, etc. So all these units and also the special methods which are available, which are to be used, will depend upon the what is the intended use of the supply. Say what is the, whether the domestic water standard itself, what the standards we are going to follow, based on that we are going to employ the methods or available among the water treatment units. Thank you.